In a world where tomorrow's blockbusters reign,
three millennials look back on our generation's classics.
On our generation's classics.
Our generation's classics. And remember.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to Millennials in the Movie House, the podcast where three friends watch our generation's beloved movies of yesterday and review them from our modern adult perspective. I'm Betsy.
I'm Tracy.
And I'm Serena.
And we all sound slightly robot-y.
We all sound like death.
All right. And today we are talking about Girl Interrupted, 1999, written by, based on a book by Susanna Kaysen, screenplay by James Mangold, Lisa Loomer, and Anna Hamilton Phelan, directed by James Mangold, starring Winona Ryder, Angelina Jolie, Clea DuVall, Brittany Murphy, Elizabeth Moss, etc., etc.
Whoopi Goldberg. Don't forget Whoopi.
Whoopi Goldberg, Jared Leto, Jeffrey Tambor, Vanessa Redgrave, Misha freaking Collins.
Right?
Listen.
I had to pause the movie.
Right?
And then, like, was that him?
Yeah. Right?
I was like, who's she? Who's
he was just in this little one scene, and it was before he was famous, but I was like, oh
and
my
he probably
God.
Had one of the best scenes of the movie.
Oh, he totally did. Oh my God.
Or the best line. Yeah, the best line.
Anyway. Yeah.
Quick synopsis, Serena.
Yeah, you knew it was going. You knew it was coming.
This is a... I'm interested to read the book, you guys.
I read the book on Sunday.
It's on my to-do list to read.
It's a very easy read, everybody.
Nice. She's holding up the book in camera, which you can't see. So this is a story that it's a true story.
It's a memoir.
It's a memoir.
It's always like based on memories. So it's like, sometimes it can be a little foggy, which is how they get away with saying something. Anyway, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no, that's good. I'm struggling to find the word. I'm like a little bit, brain cells have died when I was coughing. So it follows this girl, and she is struggling with some mental illness, and she is kind of forcefully kind of signed into a psych ward. And, you know, she goes in denial. She's like, well, I'm not like these people. And, you know, turns out she does have some stuff she needed to work through. She had originally gone in there for a suicide attempt, right? But she was playing it off like, I had a headache. Anyways, the story follows her interaction with the people that she meets at the psych ward, which, by the way, can we get a quick little, I love the shout out for local, even though it was filmed in Pennsylvania or something like that.
They changed the name of the hospital for the movie, but yeah, it is.
In real life, this is a story based on truth, obviously, and in McLean's Hospital, private insurance, baby. Creme de la creme. Anyway, sorry, I got off track. So, you know, she spends about 18 months in this McLean's Hospital, and she learns about this, you know, borderline personality disorder that is, I mean, this is placed, you guys, this happened in the 60s. Granted, the movie was 99.
Mm-hmm. The memoir was written in 93.
Right. Yeah. I did see that online. She's in there for 18 months. She learns about herself. She realizes, you know, she does have some things to work through. She ends up, there's a whole bunch of things that go on and relationships between the people there, but she gets through, kind of breaks through a wall a little bit and accepts that there is an issue. She works through it in therapy, and, you know, a year and a half later, she's released and into the world. And and there's a suicide in there. But I mean, okay, so there's highs and lows, but I mean, it's a real story. And I think that there needs to be more stuff like this out there for the public to watch, you know?
Great synopsis. So who has seen this movie? What is our exposure to it prior to this?
I've seen this movie once before, and I want to say I was in college, maybe. My roommate was obsessed with Angelina Jolie, so I think I watched all of her films. I don't know. I think when did it come out? 99?
Yeah.
Correct. Yeah.
I was a little young, I think, maybe for it. That was...
I feel like college age is the right age to watch this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it's like young, young adult women.
Yeah.
It is.
They're like late teens, maybe early 20s. Did you guys get that general gist? I didn't actually go and dig deep on the ages, but...
They were supposed to be all teenagers, being teenagers being through 19, and but most of the actresses were in their 20s, so
yep,
you kind of you didn't get like a defined age for any of them except for Susanna, which is okay, I think. But they, you know, they for in both the book and the movie, they kind of merge the themes and concepts of coming of age with mental health. And so yeah. I think college years, it's a that's a great time to be exposed to
yes.
some of these topics.
Mm-hmm. I've never seen this before, but I knew about it. I did know about the book. Mm-hmm. And it came about probably in my high school year, so somewhere between 2000 and 2004. And I had it on the back burner for something to read for a long time or watch. You know, I wanted to do both, which, you know, mm-hmm. now I got one out of the way. But I'm glad I did it, and it wasn't what I was expecting.
Fair enough. Yeah, same. I think I've watched bits and pieces of it here and there. Like, you know, there are some scenes that are very famous, like the bathtub scene for whatever, like when Val throws her into the bathtub. I feel like I've seen that on commercials. Like that's like the commercial yeah. part you see.
They always put the dramatic, most dramatic right. things in the trailer, which we'll have to talk about after, because I have right. things to say about the trailer.
And of course, you know, I've seen snippets of Angelina Jolie doing her thing
mm-hmm. with the cherry.
Yeah, at the ice yeah, cream that's shop. That's the scene. That's a big scene that I've seen yeah. a million times, and also problematic that that's the scene that we saw yeah. also.
Sex mm-hmm. sells, baby.
But yeah, I've never seen the whole thing through. And then so today's Wednesday. On Sunday, I read the book in one shot, and nice. Then the awesome. Next day I watched the movie. So
how did they compare?
I was just gonna say,
I'm actually very pleasantly surprised with how they compare.
Okay.
The characters, they made sure they got all the main characters in there, so all of these characters are based on characters from the book, and as far as I can tell, they were real people. Mm-hmm. I know that there is some element of, I don't even want to say unreliable narrator, but as you were saying,
yeah.
This is a collection of memories. She wrote this in 93, and this all happened in the 60s. So we're talking a couple decades out.
Yeah.
So I will say one thing before I forget that she did, there was mention online that she had pulled her records from.
Her records are interspersed throughout the book.
Okay.
So
that would probably be yeah. like more, but
To her credit, though, she was a writer, so I'm sure she wrote yeah. a journal and had things, or right. you know,
yeah.
She there was never a moment where I was like, I don't think that happened.
Yeah.
So first off, the way the book was written, it's not linear. It's kind of told in vignettes. She mm-hmm. tells you like a memory, and then she talks about like, you know, her diagnosis, and then she talks about a memory, and then she talks, and so it's just kind of like every chapter is its own little granular thing. Wonderfully written, because she is a writer. Like you could tell that she had a good confident voice. And so the events that she was talking about, there was never really a moment where I was like, yeah, no, that there's no way that happened.
It was believable.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. The chapters where she was giving her opinion, I was curious about. Those were interesting, seeing someone's point of view from the inside, instead of, you know, seeing mental health from, you know, a professional. You're seeing mental health from somebody who was institutionalized for it in the 60s. It's
yeah, right.
You know, and that's one of the major differences I did notice between the book and the movie, is that the book really was very plain about the fact that you're dealing with very apathetic therapists in the 60s when you're, you know, when she was put into an institution. At no point did she feel like she was getting like actual support from her therapy staff. Whereas in the movie, they glorified it. Like they went, I really got that sense. Like,
that's why it didn't feel like the 60s to me.
Dr. Wick was like this, like almost godlike therapy, you know, person. Whereas in the book, it was very like, she was like, oh yeah, Dr. Wick, like you met her for 3 minutes a day and she didn't care what you were saying. Like,
yeah,
it was interesting to see that difference. And I think that a lot of that had to do with the difference in how mental health and the mental health profession is viewed, depending on what generation you're in.
That was actually one of my notes that I took, that I remember watching it, but I don't really remember much of it. And I thought that especially older movies that deal with mental health, the mental health professionals, the therapists, are always looked in a bad light.
Yes.
Because they, first off, I don't think they knew what they were doing.
Right.
I just don't think they were trained very well or didn't understand the whole psyche or whatever. We still don't understand everything and everybody's different, but at least it's a little bit more understanding now. But you're right. And I should have realized that it was glorified for the movie, because I was pleasantly surprised that it wasn't all bad. Like, she has this moment where she's like, oh, I don't want to become Lisa.
Yeah.
I need to actually work for myself and take yes. meds and work towards getting better. But I have to be an active participant in this.
So and she takes that is a fantastic message. I like, yeah. I wholly support that message, yeah. Yeah. But you didn't really have that catharsis in the book. So
interesting.
Yeah.
That which is more of the truth, but yeah.
That's right. What pulled me out of it being the 60s. Like, I had to keep reminding myself this placement was the 60s, and I was expecting some of the state hospital horror stories of the 60s. And that's why this movie kind of wasn't fully what I was expecting it to be.
So Winona Ryder was going through a tough time in her own life personally. And her dad was a rare book salesman. Mm-hmm. I hope I got this facts right. And he found this book, Girl Interrupted, and he gave it to her because it resonated with him. And he mm-hmm. could see this character in her, where there weren't a lot of books that had this melancholy type young woman.
Mm-hmm.
And she really, really resonated with the character. And she like bought the rights to make this movie.
She did. Yeah. She fought for this movie.
I think is amazing. Yeah. Like, I don't, and she like handpicked people to be in this movie. And she, so I think, other than just making it Hollywood and, you know, making it glamorous, I think it's the 60s and this book through Winona's eyes, who she's like, you know, in the 90s or something. So it's like got that her twist on it.
Yeah. I definitely, it had a 90s sensibility set in the 60s.
One of my favorite parts of this movie is that opening probably 10 minutes or so. She says in the therapy session that time can move backwards and forwards and now to then and back again, and you can't control it.
Mm-hmm.
And in those first 10 minutes or so, you see the transitions are just amazing.
Yeah.
And you see her talking in this therapy session that basically gets her sent there, of her stomach being pumped, of like all the things leading up to it, all kind of out of order. Mm-hmm. And like, she hears something and then you switch to like the beautifully done, beautiful dialogue that got you there, that understands what was yes. going on. And
it was a very tightly written sequence. Absolutely. Yes. I totally agree with you on that. And I got to say, so this is over 2 hours. This is a 2 hour, yeah. what, 6 minute movie. It was paced. It did not feel like that.
Yeah.
And a lot of it has to do with, you just want to keep watching these girls.
I know.
The characters are beautifully fleshed out, but the actors are nailing it. They got such a lineup of actors that did their jobs.
Yep.
So,
all of the young women in Hollywood were clamoring to be in this movie.
Yep. And understandably so.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, and also, I mean, like we were saying before, they just weren't making movies like this. They weren't making movies with really in-depth characters who were dealing with very real issues. Yeah. Yep.
I think this beautifully, thank you, God, like movie picking God that we have. We need to name this God.
Yeah.
Movie roulette. I think it pairs really well with But I'm a Cheerleader.
Yes. Yeah.
I was thinking the same exact thing.
It was a 90s movie with like a 50s, 60s motif.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a 60s movie with like a 90s motif. Mm-hmm. And it was like about these like outcast girls and dealing with real life situations, to a point where Clea DuVall is in both movies.
I was going to say.
And they're Clea both DuVall, 1999.
Yeah. Right, right.
Oh, wow. Yeah. But we can see the kind of the difference between the satire of one, not the satire, but like, you know what I mean? How it's like poking fun of like, look how ridiculous this is, to the seriousness of this one.
Yeah.
That's like, this is an issue that needs to be dealt with, you know?
Yes, absolutely.
I have a question, Betts.
Yes.
Does the book at all address the title?
Yes, it does. She gives a very detailed explanation of what the title is, why it's called that. Do you want me to just explain why?
Yes,
why?
Please. Yes, because I feel like, please. Like please I read about it a little bit.
Yeah, my guess was just how she kind of her own mind frame was interrupted and that she was the girl. And that was like kind of my guess. I'm like, when she explained like how she the time does this and that, I was like, I kind of explains the title a little bit.
I always assumed that it was that her suicide attempt was interrupted. Like she
oh, interesting.
Oh, that's a good
that's I how didn't think about I that. Thought yeah. it was, but it's from other so Betts, please. Yeah,
so take it away. it comes from the title of a famous Vermeer painting called The Girl Interrupted at Her Music. So Girl Interrupted. So one of the things that she had to, you know, deal with in therapy was the fact that she had an affair with her English teacher. Mm-hmm. And so one of their outings, he took her to New York and they went to a museum and she saw this painting. And then like years later, she went back and looked at it again and she kind of had a different perspective on it. But kind of the idea of Girl Interrupted is that in her mind, being institutionalized for a year and a half interrupted her development as becoming an adult. Like if she didn't take this year and a half out, she would have gotten through it herself or would have dealt with it or would have just been more on track with her life. She was basically interrupted with this institutionalization. So
I said my favorite part being mm-hmm. that very beginning scene, like just the whole thing, the acting, the transitions, the script was great. Mm-hmm. Any other favorite parts?
Yes, favorite parts. It might have to be the acting overall. Winona Ryder, her character very much, Susanna is very much just almost an audience member. She's kind of seeing all the other girls and their issues. But I think that Angelina Jolie did a really good job. I think Brittany Murphy did a really good job.
Yeah.
And Elizabeth Moss did a really good job.
Yeah. Elizabeth Moss from Handmaid's Tale. Mm-hmm.
Did not the first time, obviously I didn't really know who Elizabeth Moss was the first time I watched it. And the second time I had to do a double take. Mm-hmm.
Well, cause she was still really young in this.
Yeah.
She was the only one who was an actual teenager. Yeah. I found it interesting that how much they decided to villainize Lisa. I guess you need a villain in a movie. And I mean, villain is a strong word for this character. She is a diagnosed sociopath. I mean, what are you going to do?
She's sick.
But that scene in the tunnel at the end kind of took me out of the movie. I don't know. It didn't feel properly placed.
I don't know about you guys, but for me, I was almost waiting the entire movie for her to turn on her. You see her kind of slap
Clea. Georgina.
Slapped her and you can kind of see like Lisa's kind of running the show and like from the first interaction between Susanna and Lisa, you're like, I don't know about you guys, but I was just waiting for her to turn on her and be like, I don't like you. You're not going to be part of our club. You can't sit with us.
Yeah.
Well, especially because the first time she enters the scene, she's screaming at Susanna about Jamie.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell?
But so, like, I think that is part of the whole, that's why I think it was okay in this movie. It didn't really come out of nowhere. At one point she calls Susanna Jamie.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And she lost her friend and it was because she ran away or did whatever she did. And I think it's because she's a sociopath or whatever, but she still has some feelings. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like she's got, you know, so here she is, another friend of hers, just like Brittany Murphy's character was cured and left, you know what I mean? But not really, but this other girl did, she got better and she's leaving and here, but she's seeing it as losing another friend.
Yeah.
So here she is. So I think she reacts this way. Cause she's like, I am never going to get out of here. I'm losing another friend. And to your point of her being the villain, she calls herself this. She's like, I've made the, you know what I mean? I think you see her kindness when she's with the other patients.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So the girls are your favorite part. Serena, what about you?
The relationship between Val and Susanna, mm-hmm. it was complex, there were some ups and downs, obviously, right? Suzanne is going through a lot. You can see at the end, I mean, Val basically sheds a tear when she leaves. And, you know, she's all business and there's a little bit of, I really like Whoopi Goldberg's.
I did too. She was actually, I wrote her down as my like second, like runner up for favorite part.
I think she did
amazing.
Well, I was going to ask if anyone won awards, but then I didn't know if that came up in your Tracy's fun facts.
I think Angelina Jolie did.
I think everyone's acting was awesome. Really. Like everything was believable. There was a few things that I, you know, wish there was more of, but that's.
Do we think that this had an impact on our generation?
I'd say yes.
The elder millennials, I think, yeah, I agree. I think that this was definitely one of the only movies, especially for girls, for millennial women.
Yeah.
This was one of the few movies that had these kinds of characters dealing with these kinds of issues. And
that's true.
From a female perspective, I think it's such a rarity that it has to be remembered and it has to be part of, you know, our shared history.
Yeah, that's true.
All right. I think those are all the notes I got.
What's everybody watching? Because a while ago, I had a conversation with a coworker and we were talking about TV shows and how back then, if you missed an episode, you missed it. Like there was no DVD later. There was no Netflix or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I was saying that one of my favorite TV shows, I had been trying to find a DVD of it, but like it was a season and like it was like it would have cost more money than it would have made because nobody was going to buy this DVD set. And then honestly, I kind of forgot about it and then whatever. And she goes, well, what TV show? And she immediately found it for me on Amazon Prime for $10. And I'm like, are you kidding me? The show was Higher Ground, which right. I thought was an amazing TV show, but it only lasted a season, but it was the early aughts of coming of age, teenagers and mental illness. It really focused on like sexual assault, bulimia, like all this other kind of like, but, it's not that great. It was this made for TV, like a after school special, but I secretly love it and it's not that bad. So go watch it.
You don't secretly love it. You openly love it.
I openly love it.
Martini shop. Would you recommend this movie?
I'm going to say yes. I'm going to say yes because it's a story of the 60s rewritten in the 93. Movied in the 99 and even today in the 22, it's still relevant.
Mm-hmm.
And it's important that people have this perspective from the inside because not everyone has an immediate family member with these types of things. Some people just have no idea that this stuff's even a thing, or people are out there struggling and undiagnosed for their entire life or a couple of decades or something when therapy is like the number one.
Normalized therapy.
Yeah. Normalized therapy. Exactly. Like, so I'm going to say yes, but for the good of the public.
I will also say yes. And the reason why I was hesitating is this isn't a fun movie. It's not.
No.
But it's a good movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's well acted, well scripted, well everything. You know what I mean? But it's not a good time movie, but if you want just a decent, you know, and you want that, you know, perspective, it's good.
I agree. I'm also a yes. And even if you can't identify with the girls, it's still like Serena was saying, it's good to have that perspective. And there are varying perspectives in this movie. You'll get something out of it no matter what.
There's one thing that I forgot to mention about the movie, and I don't know if you can take this and throw it back or not, but
go for it.
You guys, okay, the trailer like made me think there was going to be all these like lovely scenes of like, you know, Jared Leto and like shirtless.
You mean first edition Zac Efron?
Dude, he really looked exactly like him. I couldn't even believe it. I was dying.
I had this moment, like my brain couldn't compute, I thought it was and I was him. Like, is that sacrifice? It's 1999. What is happening?
His eyes were just shocking.
All right, guys. Are we ready for next movie?
Ready?
All right, I'm sending you strong vibes for movies that I already know I want to watch.
Sister Act, Sister Act,
Toy Story.
Yay! And I've seen that one. That's an easy, fun watch. I've seen that 100 times.
Is that our first Disney movie?
Pixar?
It's our first Pixar.
I love Pixar.
Sorry, Pixar.
Yeah, and you know what? Cool. I think we were avoiding. The only Disney one we watched was Black Cauldron, I think.
And a DCOM, but that doesn't count. Thanks for joining us. If you like what you hear, you can find more great episodes over on our website, www.millennialsofthemoviehouse.com, or wherever you find your podcasts. Curious about updates, extras from our episodes, or want to add your 2 cents about a reviewed movie? We're also on Twitter and Instagram. Our handle for both is @TheMovieMillies. Check us out and make sure to follow us. So until next time.
We're millennials.
And we'll see you at the movie house.